What's up, everybody? It's Alex from Heavy New York, and on the phone we got Carl Kennedy. Thank you for your time today, man. I appreciate it.
Hey, thank you, Alex. This time where there's no live music, it's great to be doing an interview.
Yeah, this is the only chance I have socializing, and I live in the middle of Manhattan, so it's...
Oh, man, you guys are locked down big time.
Yep, but I gotta say, though, nothing is more metal than interviewing, like, a bunch of black metal bands and heavy metal bands in the heart of a quarantine zone during a pandemic. I just gotta say that right now.
Why, so the people who are really edgy to begin with get a little edgier?
Yep, exactly. Like, everybody's telling their quarantine stories. I'm like, I'm interviewing heavy metal bands and all this shit.
Well, watch the questions, Alex. We're going to get crazy.
Exactly.
No, I'm fine.
But before we, you know, like, one thing that everybody knows is you released Warrior earlier this month. You just want to talk about, like, how the making of this record was and, like, the recording and all that fun stuff?
Yeah, absolutely. Tony, Mike, and Charlie had a band called TLC, Totally Lost Cause, and Heaven and Hell Records is releasing their CDs from the 90s. And so they had a TV show, and their drummer bailed on them, or wasn't able to make it, whatever happened, and they asked me to fill in. So I did the TV show with them. It went really well. And after that, we were like, hey, we should write some music. So it was a really organic thing. The guys are great. They've been together, you know, on and off as a band. They were in a band together for years, and they released songs. So it was a case of me just coming in and, you know, adding what little bit I could. But the majority of the songwriting was Tony, Mike, and Charlie. And we rehearsed at a studio. There's a local studio here called The Rec Room. Cliff Evans owns it. And we would go there on Monday nights, and we just started writing. And it was great for me. Cliff is a drummer also, besides owning the studio. So he had a set of drums there for me. So we walk in and we'd rehearse, we'd write songs for a few hours and over a period of time. And all of a sudden we had enough songs for an album. We started recording.
Yeah. For people who may have only heard the title track, Warrior, because I believe that was the first single off this album.
Yes.
And, you know, I enjoyed, like, the whole album. Like, In This Sign is one of my favorite songs in here. And
I love that song, too.
Yeah, that's...
Very heavy.
Yep. But, like, for people who may have just heard that single, could that may serve as, like, a clear representation of what the whole album is? Or do you think that that's just scratching the surface?
You know, it's hard for me to say. And somebody asked me, well, what's your favorite track? Or how would you represent the band? And I have to say that I think the album is solid from top to bottom, and any one song pretty much represents the band. And even though, because of the whole pandemic, we've only been able to play one job live, we were able to play all the songs live and do a great job with them. You know, we did justice to every one of them. So I think they're all representative of the band. So In This Sign is as good a representation as any of them.
Okay. Was there kind of like an underlying preconceived idea of what you wanted this album to sound like, or did you guys just want to, like, kind of improvise and let things fall into place?
Yeah, I don't think, though, none of us really came in with anything preconceived. I think it was a different thing for all of us. I think for the three of them had worked together, and I had, of course, worked with, you know, the Rods and with other musicians. And so coming in, it was a different thing for each of us. I wasn't used to working the way they were. They weren't used to working the way I did. So we wound up finding a happy medium. I actually loved it. I was probably more of an adjustment for them than it was for me, but I really loved it. So it was very organic, and I'm sure they weren't, like, their drummer, excuse me, that their drummer contributed to songwriting, but I've always been involved in songwriting, always been involved in arranging. So I would put in my two cents here and there, and it'd be very minor, but, you know, it would be something that they maybe weren't used to, and I think they liked that, the fact that they had that fourth member contributing. So I think it was a great experience for all of us at the end of the day, and I think the product speaks for itself. We're a band, and I think over the year and a half that we did that, you know, we became a band.
Yeah. Well, one thing I was always curious about is, being that you've played with a lot of different bands and so have the other members, was it maybe kind of like combining your previous experiences into one sort of project, or did you guys just kind of want to do something you never did before?
No, I think we probably wanted to do something a little different, but it's also, whenever you do something, I think we wanted to do something more modern, but we all have roots in, you know, go back to Black Sabbath, and you know, so like, so we all have basic roots from when we were kids, and also listen to a lot of modern music. So I think that's something that really came through. So I don't think we were trying to do anything, but I think the fact that we all brought a different musical sensibility to the album, to the music and songwriting, I think that just created what became Kennedy.
Yeah, and being, and I'd imagine playing with so many projects between the Rods and, you know, a brief time with Manowar, that, like, I'd imagine every project you've been involved with has taught you new things, right?
It has, you know, it totally is. Everything I do, I approach with an open mind, and try to, I've been playing for 22 years with the Jeffrey James Band here in Scranton, and it's an 8-piece horn band, and you know, at one point I was like, I don't need to do this, maybe I'm going to leave the band. And my daughter said, you love playing your drums, like, why would you stop? Just because it's a different kind of music. And so I thought about it, and I went back to, and I didn't leave the band, but what I did was, I started applying what I was practicing and learning, and then I would take the cover songs we were doing, and I would spend time really listening and trying to get into the mindset and the grooves and the feel and what each drummer was doing and what the feel of the song was. And it totally helped me as a drummer. It opened up to so many different things. So many good things came out of that. So I was glad that, you know, my daughter told me that, and I realized that she was right. I love playing my drums. And so, but I do approach every project differently. And with Kennedy, it gave me an opportunity. I think it's some of my best drumming. That gave me an opportunity to, you know, bring probably more of my own style to it than I have in other things, because we wrote together. And whereas a lot of times the songs are just, I either write them or David writes them in the Rods, or if I'm doing a project for someone else. Like this past week, I've done two songs for Bryn Ahrens and Brad Denzel from TKO, and, you know, totally the songs are written. So I'm playing for that song, not necessarily trying to put my style or force my style of drumming into that song. I play for the song.
Yeah. Well, it's funny you mentioned that, like, every project calls for a different approach. I've had this conversation with a bunch of different drummers who are all in multiple projects, because I think it's fair to say that in the end, whether you're playing smooth jazz or you're playing, you know, death metal, in the end, the whole point of drums is keeping the rhythm and keeping the beat. You know, the famous saying, your drummer sucks, your band sucks. But
yes, that's well said, and I think Miles Davis had the saying that if the drummer ain't happening, the band ain't happening, and it's true. And I always try to impart that wisdom to young drummers who just want to play crazy fills and are amazing, but the pulse isn't there. And I try to explain to them, no matter what you're playing, there has to be basically that heartbeat, that pulse of the music and the song. And if you're not serving that, then you're really doing a disservice to the song.
Yeah, look at it as a person. It doesn't matter how good-looking the person is. If they don't have a pulse, it's not, you know, it doesn't matter how good they look on the outside, right?
Exactly, that's right.
Maybe a bit of a morbid analogy there, but
it is morbid, but I like it.
It's metal. and it's funny. As a drummer, do you need music before you lay down the rhythm and the beat, or has there ever been a time where you had, like, a whole drum arrangement down and the rest of the band could write over that?
Yes, there is, and I think it's every now and then that happens. The first album in the Rods, it's a song called Woman that I wrote. David had never heard it, and we were in the studio, and we had, back then studio time was expensive. I record at home now, we all have home studios, so there's no time crunch about paying $80 an hour to go in and have a bad day in the studio that, you know, costs you $600. So we were in the studio, and we had basically 15 minutes left of studio time before we had to strike the drums and get out. And I had a song called Woman, so I just played it. I had the song, I had written it on guitar, but I had the song in my head, the arrangement, so I played the arrangement, and that's the song you hear on the first Rods album, which is called Woman. That was just me playing, laying down the drum track and teaching the parts to the guys after.
That's impressive, and I'd imagine that sounds like a little weird, because, like, you have the whole drum pattern laid down. It makes it easier, because then the guitar player or the vocalist knows not to go one syllable or one, like, you know, section over the drum pattern.
Right. Well, it was easy once the drums were down, but for them, hearing the drum track, they had no idea what the music was going to be. So for them, it was like the Wild West. It was wide open, you know, had could have gone in any number of directions until I showed them the song, playing the chorus for them and showing them the idea for the melody.
Yeah, kind of going back to the Warrior album again, because in the end, drums, like I said before, like it has, you know, a similar purpose for every style of music you play. But I've noticed many different like vibes and emotions behind this. Like I thought, you know, Not Even Love is very different from a song like Lies or Hell Ride, different from a song like In This Sign. So like it's fair to say that there was many different emotions and many different sort of vibes that all the members are feeling at that time, right? Even though it's a drummer, there's no melody incorporated in there. I'd imagine there's a lot of emotion and feeling behind the playing as well, right?
Absolutely. I mean, I think the music's very... I think it was trying to approach the music almost cinematically, you know, symphonically and almost like a soundtrack, trying to create a wave of emotions and feelings. So we tried not to be just one riff hammered to death, you know. We tried to have dynamics in different parts. And of course, Mike has a very spiritual and very lyrics have a lot of depth to them. And Tony, his lyrics, like In This Sign, for example, is a student of the Roman Empire. So you have a lot of that, his lyrics infused with that. So those stories are based on, you know, his knowledge of that. So, you know, you have lyrics that have some substance to them as well as the music taking you in different directions.
Mm-hmm. And you're also working as a producer, because I know that you've worked with artists such as Anthrax and Overkill. So, like, when you're working with another artist, are they kind of, like, looking for you to bring your own mix or your own vision into their project, or do you kind of have to, like, to adjust everything you know to what they do?
When I produce, I try to examine what they're doing, listen to what they're doing, understand it, and then what their vision is for going forward, and then I try to facilitate that as best I can. And if I hear where the band, somebody needs a little more time because they may be great live, but in the studio, under the microscope, they need to tighten it up, you know, I'll work with them on that. I'll work with the band on arrangements. But my goal is to really help the band realize their vision. And especially if they're inexperienced in the studio, I want to capture that energy. So, and their vision as best I can.
Yeah.
But I never try to insinuate myself into a band's music other than maybe suggest arrangement ideas.
Mm-hmm. Do you find it harder to maintain an energy or maintain a vision or even capture a moment the longer you're working on something?
I don't. And, you know, I've been in the studio 12-hour days and gotten into the car. In fact, Alex Perialis said it to me one time. We came out of the studio after we'd been working 12 hours, and we got in the car, and I turned the radio on. He's like, "What? You want to hear me?" I'm like, "Yeah, I just want to listen to something." And, you know, so it always worked. It's that way for me. I never get burned out on something because I think I dial in on, if we're working on the bass, then I'm listening for intonation, I'm listening to the parts, I'm listening to, are all the notes even, and so on, and, you know, is it locking in? So I'm dialed in on one specific thing. I'm not hearing the song per se. I'm listening to that one thing to make that part of the whole. And so I want to make sure that that part is fitting into the big picture for the whole of the song. So it's not like I'm listening, even though it may be a number of times we're going through it, it's me not playing the song 50 times. It's going over a part and then adding another part. And so I don't burn out like other people, I think, do.
Mm-hmm. Are you ready for the most difficult question of the whole interview? I get everybody with this one.
No, I'm not. I'm not, Alex. So wait, let me take a breath. Okay, go ahead.
How do you know when a song is done?
It's never done.
I get that all the time. That's the default answer.
No, it's not. It really is the fact that there are so many factors that go into the song being completed. And sometimes it's financial. Your budget runs out. Sometimes the band has to go on tour. The studio isn't available anymore. It's been booked. And then other times, you know that you want to do something more. It's not quite where you were hoping it would be, but you also have to recognize that now we have to call it. We don't know where else to take it. I think we've done everything we can to the song. We're done. Even though we probably wish we could figure out that one extra little piece or that little piece of the mix that just clears everything up or makes it that much more powerful. Mm-hmm. And so in that regard, it's never done. It really is true. But there is a point when it comes where it comes to it's done. You know, you just have to call it.
Yeah.
So.
And being a drummer too, because there's so many different angles you could approach it. Like you know, maybe like it amazes me on how much like a song changes because that person hit the crash cymbal here instead of the ride cymbal, or vice versa, or you know, they added double bass instead of single. Like it's just so amazing on how like a certain adjustment to the drum pattern and the arrangement could adjust to the whole composition.
How we can take the energy up or take it down, and you know, an interesting thing that I learned was in terms of cymbals and where you place these things. It's if you listen to the Four Seasons music, you know, from the 60s, you listen to that, there are big drum fills, but there are no cymbal crashes. The drum fills in, no cymbal crashes. And what that did was it facilitated an incredibly clear mix, because you weren't dealing with cymbal overhang and so on. So if you ever listen to it, keep in mind there are no cymbals, and you note that, and you'll see the difference. And so that's where you can really tell a good example of what happens with drumming and a mix, because drums are the hardest thing to mix, because you have a lot of transients, you have a lot of dynamics, so you've got cymbals ringing over, cymbals that are being caught by compression, so now that's changing them a little bit. It's just a lot of different aspects of that, of a drum track. And, you know, now with parallel compression and whatever, you have a lot of options, but still, it's not easy. And with drum triggering, that helps keep things consistent. But, you know, you have to watch triggering drums, because at some point, it's just you just program drums. It's like a drum machine. And I've had bands send me things that are like a basic ballad that's just one simple beat. I'm like, why do you want me to play drums on this? All I'm going to try to do is emulate a drum machine. So why not just use a drum machine? Like,
yeah.
So.
And in conclusion, I think the best thing to say is just because you're not hitting the drums hard doesn't mean the song can't be hard hitting. So.
Exactly right. It's about the tone you pull out of the drum.
Exactly.
You're absolutely right. That takes a lot of, you know, I used to break sticks and heads and not so much heads, but cymbals, you know, very expensive. I haven't cracked a cymbal in decades now, because once I learned technique, it changed everything. So over time, you learn to pull the sound out of the drum, hopefully.
Yeah, you just jinxed it now. I guarantee when you practice tonight, you're going to...
I'm going to need your address, Alex, because I'm going to have to send you the bill for the cymbals. Fortunately, I have an endorsement of Cautious cymbals, so I will, you know, fortunately I have that, but so far I haven't had to use it. They don't replace anything because I don't break it, but now when they do, I'll send you the bill.
All right, I appreciate it. Can you just sign it for me, please?
I will. I'll sign it for you along with the bill.
All right, thank you. So before we go, I want to thank you so much for your time today. You know, obviously thanks to a virus that shall not be named. I don't want to give it any promotion. Is there just anything you would like to promote for Kennedy? Like, obviously when this is over, can we maybe be expecting to see you guys on the road quite a bit?
Well, first let me say thank you to you, because, you know, we're not out there playing live. It's tough. Even though I have a legacy, but the band is new. And it's difficult to break a new band. It's difficult to break an older band. And, you know, I really appreciate what you're doing, you know, to support us. So we're really grateful for that. So thank you. I think I always want, when we play gigs, to meet the fans. I have very good friends around the world now, people I've met at gigs, and they've come back time after time, and we've just become good friends over the years, and a lot of times they will travel with, so come and travel from show to show. So I always like meeting the fans. Hopefully they won't be paying for a meet and greet with any of the bands I'm in. As much as I understand the economics, I'm not a fan of fans who already support the band by coming out having to pay to go say hi and take a photo. But, you know, KennedyBand.com, you can check out everything. And there is something coming up where we are going to do a concert. I can't announce it quite yet, but it just came in today that we're going to be doing a live concert, streaming concert. And So I'm very excited about that, and I'm excited about what good things are happening for Kennedy despite the pandemic, who shall not be named.
Yeah, you know, better days are coming, just slightly delayed. That's how I'm looking at it.
That's a great way to look at it, because that's the way it should be and the way it will be.
Yeah, definitely. And I look forward to you sending me that bill. But thank you so much.
Thank you. And the autograph symbol, Alex. You got it. Thank you.
But everybody, we are here with Carl Kennedy. Be sure to pick up Warrior if you haven't already. We'll see you next time on Heavy New York.